Okay, let's go now.
Hi, everybody. This is Roy Even, and I am very excited to have three amazing guests here to talk about the amazing new album, Troika, which by now I'm sure you've seen all over the web, all over Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, everything online.
And I'm sure nobody knows what it means.
We will get to that especially. But you know these guys, but let's introduce them anyway. Ross Jennings, Nick DiVirgilio, and Neil Morse. We want to talk about the album, want to talk about how you know, you guys came up with this cool concept and the songs and the singles and everything. But I want to start first, Neil, with you, because I think this kind of started with you, right? Initially writing some acoustic songs. You want to talk about how that came to be from you getting started?
Yeah, I just got inspired. It was in October and November of 2020. I wrote What You Leave Behind in October. I was at visiting my daughter. She was just moving into, her and her husband was moving into a place in Colorado Springs. I have to add that because they're like, oh, he would feel left out. Like, oh, thank you that, you know, I was there too. Anyway. Yeah. And I was just, I don't know, something about Colorado, you know, some of the acoustic guitar and harmony and, I don't know. I just started writing some stuff like that. And I've always wanted to make a record, you know, like the early Crosby, Stills, and Nash albums or those. There's a lot of really great three-part harmony acoustic bands. Yeah. You know, I was influenced by all of that stuff, all the three-part harmony of the Beatles, all the three-part harmony of Yes. We've always been singing together. I mean, that was one of the things I think we discovered in Spox, Nick, when we first, you know, I knew you were a great drummer from that jam night thing, but when I found out about your voice, it changed the way I wrote, you know?
Cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, because, you know, we would hang out and just sing together and just for fun and like, oh, yeah. Like I wrote June for years before it came out, I just thought that it would be nice to have something to give people's ears a rest between the epics.
Right.
You know, that's my thinking then. But, you know, I've always really liked that kind of approach. And, you know, I'm to a place in my life where I enjoy listening to mellower music, actually. And so I kind of threw it out there. I started thinking about who would I like to make a record like this with. And that was, I guess, the beginning.
Yeah. Well, Nick, then let's jump to you, because I guess you were the next in line to join this thing. You know, talk about working again with Neil and approaching it from this kind of singer-songwriter harmony thing that you guys have a long history with, and it sure seems to blend so naturally. It's really amazing.
Well, guys, all the guys can sing their keisters off, so that was very easy. It's an easy go-to for there for sure. But like Neil was saying, back in the day, you know, we would finish a Spox concert and then go on the tour bus and sing songs until like 4 a.m. I don't know how we did it every night, just partying. I mean, it was crazy, but we did it all the time. And I know Neil's background with his family and stuff and the brothers growing up, you guys sang a ton together. So he kind of definitely has a lot of that in his history. And I love all that music as well. So singing together was definitely an inspiration, but also the fact that I've been writing a lot more music in this stage of my life and just getting, I got really inspired once Neil sent me that first email or gave me the call, you up for doing something like this? And then I went, well, yeah, sure. Cause I've just, it's a great exercise into seeing if you can make music like this. And so I got really inspired and wrote You Set My Soul on Fire pretty much immediately after he called and asked. So wow. It was just a really kind of a fun, very inspiring project to think about.
So at that stage, did you know yet that you were going to call Ross? Were you trying to think of who the third person would be? How did Ross's name come up in this? And then Ross, I want to hear from you about getting the email or phone call or however it went.
Yeah, it was, I was trying to think of who would be a good other person. I thought a lot of people that would be, you know, have great voices would be great. I was just trying to think about also, you know, wanting it to be more like a meeting of artists rather than just, you know, getting people to sing on songs that I wrote. You know, I wasn't really interested in that. And so, yeah, it was right around the time that I think, I don't know who was the mastermind behind the marketing of the Transatlantic album, The Absolute Universe, but somebody had the idea to have us interview, have us be interviewed by other peers. Like, so I was interviewed by Ted Leonard. And then, was that you? I thought it might've been you. Yeah. So you're part of this thing, man, because, you know, I met Ross many times and always enjoyed being around him and love his voice and everything. But what had me think about him was that he interviewed Mike.
Right.
It was Mike. Yeah. He interviewed Mike for the, and I watched a bit of that because it's always interesting to watch other people talk about making a record that you made with them because they always have a different perspective, you know, of course. But that had me thinking about Ross, and then I shot out the email.
Yeah, it's the easiest audition I've ever had, honestly. chatting to Mike. But right. I mean, I imagine it was a massive leap of faith on your part, Neil, because I'm not known for having done this style of music before. And you've only ever heard me in Haken, I imagine. I don't think you even knew that I played guitar. I'm not sure.
No, I didn't.
or wrote songs like the songs that we've written, you know, in this vein. So it was a complete surprise to me to receive your email and want me to be involved. But obviously without hesitation, I was like, yes, of course. I mean, I've grown up singing along to Spock Spears music my whole, my whole adult life, really. So, yeah, to jump at the opportunity of working with you guys was a no-brainer.
You were working on this solo record that was in line with some of this kind of stuff, which is, you know, that they didn't know that was happening.
It's divine timing in a way, because, a lot of the stuff I was writing, I think I confessed to you on our interviews on that record that I was starting out to make a kind of country record. And my whole solo album is littered with three-part harmonies. So I had a lot of material bubbling in that style. So, yeah, it was really... really crazy how you came to arrive at thinking of me, because that's obviously what I was trying to put out into the universe at that point.
Yeah. The thing that is obviously the main focus, I think, on the record, when most people hear it and from the singles that are out already, are the harmonies. They're really elaborate, and they sound amazing. So the process of working on that, you've probably all seen the Beatles documentary where you see Paul and John working out specific notes and they're sitting next to each other and they're, you know, trying to find the right notes to harmonize. How did you guys work that out without being in the same room? How does that, what's the process there in doing something so complicated?
It's, you just sort of experiment. I think what's easy is that, Ross and I have a higher range of voice than Neil. And so at least for my songs, I was trying to see how we could combine the two where I didn't, like in Spock's days, I always sang all the high parts. Right. So it was nice to know that I didn't have to sing all that. And Ross could take that. We can blend it a certain way. So it was just, we kind of set stuff back and forth and wrote opinions, you know, on certain songs and on what we were going to try and do and just, and sent stuff back and forth to see how it sounded and kind of just always landed on stuff rather easily. As far as blends were concerned,
do you, you know, go into those saying, bringing in your kind of musical technical knowledge, like, you know, hey, you're going to take the fifth on these and you'll take, you know, you'll do the middle thirds or, you know, that kind of chord construction when you're doing these things, or it's more of just a feel when you're trying to find the notes?
Neil? Well, since we were doing it remotely, we sent guide tracks around, you know, where I had only heard, you know, until we were way into, I've said this in many interviews, but, you know, I didn't hear us all on one track till like.
Yeah, way later into this
mid-May,
process.
Mid-May or something like that.
That's amazing.
Been working on the record for months because Nick didn't do his vocals till the very end. It's all Nick's fault, actually.
It's all my fault. Sorry.
And by the way, you had all the high parts in Spock's because you're the only person that could possibly sing them.
Well, you know, that's how it goes.
So we sent guide tracks, and it's not like most of the time with a couple of exceptions. These kinds of songs are not like particularly difficult to figure out what the harmonies are going to be. You know, they're pretty much following the chords, you know what I mean? It's root, third, and fifth mostly. Right. It's not like jazz or something, you know, we're not putting in nines and sixes or things like that generally, usually, you know. So, you know, I wanted it to be, my hope was that it was going to be, you know, pretty simple, you know, and not overly crowded sonically, you know, and just kind of that nice, if you listen to a lot of older records and things that I really like the early Crosby, Stills, and Nash albums, there isn't that much stuff going on. You know, sometimes it's just their three voices and one acoustic guitar. And I really like that. So I think we were all kind of coming from the same place on these things. And it was from my perspective, this was a breeze of an album to make, you know, because a lot of the stuff that you guys sent, I thought was just great. Like from the demos, mm-hmm. you know, sometimes the demos are just, they're the right thing. And like, I dug that piano solo in Julia. So I was like, well, I mean, I could play a piano solo, but hey man, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. So a lot of the stuff was like, well, what does this really need? I guess I'll just add some bass. Maybe I'll add a little bit of organ and sing the low part, and we're ready to mix, man. It was great.